Hello, everybody. I'm very delighted today to have Mr. Prakash Seshadri, the author of The Spiritual CEO, in conversation with me today. Mr. Prakash, welcome.
Pleasure, sir. Good morning to you too.
Good morning. I would like to have a brief introduction of Mr. Prakash. Mr. Prakash is also known as Corporate Yogi. He's the founder and CEO of Sea Change Consulting. He's known for his path-breaking work and several friends, be it writing books, turning around organization, CEO coaching, being keynote speaker, a movie consultant, sports coach, and have a passion for efforts in nation building. He has been meditating for close to 30 years. That yes, is really an amazing journey you might be having. And he likes to mix management, leadership, and the spiritual aspect of it in his writings and in his keynote addresses. Great efforts, Prakash. And it
Thank
is, I'm really privileged to have
you
today.
And pleasure is mine.
Yeah, and also the opportunity to speak to you more about the your book, The Spiritual CEO.
Yes, sir. The world needs to know about you also. Would you like to?
Prakash, I've been in corporate world for last 28 years. Started off in consumer industry and then moved on to shipping logistics infrastructure. Mostly the kind of projects which I did was like a turnaround startup kind of each assignments have been like that.
So
currently I have co-founded a company in supply chain, integrated supply chain. My company's name is Access Supply Chain Solutions. We do end-to-end integrated solution. Prior to this, I was CEO and director of Adani Logistics. Before that, 9 years with American President Line APL as the managing director in India region and in Middle East. And I also spend 10 years of my life with A.P. Moller Maersk. So I do also a few strategy consulting and also in the board of advisory of few companies. And that's a little bit about me. And of course, I have the passion for reading. I mainly read spiritual inclined books as well as I like to read the books on turnaround of companies and how they have gone through that journey. These are few books which I normally go through. So, Prakash, let us get more into your book because this is something which I feel in the current context very very apt, and I think it's the right time you have come up with this this work. Can you just give viewers a little bit more about the book and the key objectives?
Thank you, sir. It's in fact a great pleasure talking to such a stalwart like you who has spent so much time in corporate life. I'm very sure the conversation will help us dig a few areas for the benefit of those who watch the video. So this is my 11th book. I started writing way back in 1998, which was my first book. And the book was appreciated a lot, and Tata McGraw-Hill bought the worldwide rights and relaunched the book with a lot of rewriting involved. And subsequently, I've written a lot of books, and this happens to be my 11th book, which is being released by Amazon, Westland Books in India, Amazon globally. About a year back, when the pandemic was yet to really unfold the way it has, a few of our colleagues and friends were all sitting and talking. And one thing which repeatedly came about is the mainstream of life, which is the corporate life, and the alternate stream, as it's known, the spiritual or value-based life, always seemed to be running like two tracks in a railway track, but never seemed to meet each other at any point of time. And there's always a feeling that there is a lot that both can help complement each other with. See, all of us wear at least two hats. We have our belief system, the spiritual, religious, whatever, and how we must lead our life based on the scriptures that we have read and grown up with, whichever faith it may be. whether you're a Hindu or a Muslim or a Christian, you have some faith with which you have been ingrained, your thought patterns have been ingrained. But during the day when we work for our living, which is the corporate life, we seem to keep that aside and continue to do whatever we need to do for the corporate life, the only focus being making money to a great extent, at least to a great extent. And there seems to be a good possibility of a seamless marriage between these two lives. We don't need to shell one for the other. And in my study of about 20, 25 years with many of the leading corporates, I've seen that some of the corporates who have really shown well, even in tough times, like the pandemic that we are going through, are the ones who have been able to balance values and also the corporate pursuit of making business and making profits. And I found that they seem to do it much more easily without creating that much of stress and pressure. And this is what led me to write this book titled The Spiritual CEO, where I explore the path of the life of a CEO, where every CEO is in sort of a dilemma. I have coached hundreds and hundreds of CEOs, and many of them, when I talk to them in private, they always say that, Prakash, running just after the money alone is nauseating. We need to find a higher purpose, which whatever that higher purpose may be, the calling can be different for each. But they, for whatever reason, they were unable to express that. And many of them are able to express it once they quit the job of a CEO. So the fundamental, the distribution platform that I chose as a CEO is each CEO, whether it's a small organization or a large organization, people tend to get easily influenced by the final decision maker, who is probably the CEO, could be the MD, could be the prime minister of a country. When I say CEO, CEO is like a head of an organization. And when you modify their thinking, help them change how they look at business and how they can flourish without compromising certain values, we felt, or rather I felt, that there could be something that they can go back and implement. And that's how this book writing started. And in the process, of course, I had to meet a lot of CEOs, talk to them, all virtually due to the pandemic. And it gave me a lot of insights, and I hooked, sort of hooked all of them together on the platform of mythology, building stories and then weaving the stories to convey practical messages in the corporate world. And that seems to resonate well. Now the book is already 2 weeks into the market. I've been getting a lot of reviews where people have been able to. In fact, yesterday I got a WhatsApp message from someone who traced my mobile number from a housewife. She said that though you have said this is a spiritual CEO book, I bought it with a lot of reluctance because I like spirituality. I was curious because I had not much to do, so I bought this book and I started reading. She said I was hooked from beginning to end. This book is not for a CEO, this book is for everyone, because it seems to speak about values which we can bring to life and still lead a balanced material life. So that's a simple, I would say, a synopsis of how I landed up writing this book, sir.
Excellent, excellent, Prakash. See, from the practical life of a CEO, since I've been running the organization, I'm lucky to have that kind of a role for some time. See, as a CEO leader of your organization, you're always under tremendous pressure to perform.
Correct.
Expectation from various stakeholders, like your shareholder, your employees, your customers. So, you know, this you're always in that that pressure mode, because certain times this expectation contradicts. So how to bring in a spiritual quotient into this? And from your research, how do you find, you know, how we should maneuver that, you know, that phase in our CEO life?
See, for an Indian mind, we are all accustomed to the concept of karma, karmic balance. We understand that there is a concept of karma which somehow intricately weaves into our lives. For a Western mind, which may not accept karma, I have used the word in this book, the cause and effect syndrome. Anything which is an effect must have been caused by something, even if the creation, for example. If there is a creation that you see, there should have been a creator. It could not have come on its own. Everything has a cause. And likewise, when you are looking at the effect, which is the financial result that people are running after, which comes through customer acquisition, business expansion, better strategies, using your people to capture more markets, coming out with innovative products and services and things like that. But in a very restricted way, many of the top level executives have consistently been running after only the results, not understanding that the effect or the result that they see can be modified in a better way if they look at the costs. The cost for them has never been seriously analyzed. There has been some research done in the 90s, which some of the top organizations in the world, including India, I'm very sure even Adani might have started implementing in some way, is called the triple bottom line. In a triple bottom line, they do not talk about the financials alone. They give equal weightage to two more factors other than finance, at least for the CEO or the MD who runs the company. One is the financial bottom line, which is including a turnover and PAT and EBITDA or whatever. The second is the people bottom line, as they call. In fact, at least one big organization is Tata's in India. They have implemented this in a big way. One third of the focus of the CEO is also to be given on taking care of the main core asset of the organization, which is the people. And the third one is the society bottom line, where you don't just tap into what the society gives you, you also give it back. For example, you have set up a water plant in some place where you're tapping into the groundwater, and you are left with a moral responsibility of replenishing the water, at least that you have tapped from the ground. These three bottom lines have famously now been called as the TBL, which I've allocated one full chapter. And in the last 5 to 10 years, this has metamorphosized into spiritual bottom line. They're speaking about peace, happiness, growth, allowing people to express themselves other than just being manipulated to only impact your P&L and balance sheet. All these seem to resonate with many of the CEOs. In one of the recent interviews, I was just saying that maybe we're slightly ahead of time in releasing this book or writing about a concept, but someone has to start. In fact, one CEO who read the book remarked that he hasn't found a perfect match between spiritual and material values without compromising the material focus of an organization. So it seemed to resonate somehow, sir. I mean, that's all I can say.
Yeah, my question follows that, especially on the karma side of it. I fully agree with you. We all believe in that. But when you convert that into a organizational context, as a CEO, you need to push for results. But at the same time, you can't just make sure, like, I did everything, now I wait for the results. Because at certain times, you have to make the results happen also.
Okay. So
you know, do you think there's a contradiction? Because you know, how that karma part can be put into, you know, into well use in an organizational context? Because you can't just sit and say, like, yeah, I've done everything, now let it happen. What's your view on that?
See, I am not taking a defeatist view of karma in this book. In fact, I'm taking a very proactive, positive view. If you look at even the pandemic that has struck the world in the last 1 year, with the second wave going very strong while we are recording this, and a third wave maybe set to happen, we don't know. How did it get caused? Did man cause it, or are we a byproduct of somebody else doing something on this? Those who have read the scriptures, Mahabharata, Ramayana, and whatever, we all at least know that what you sow is what you will reap, to put it in a very simple way. Good thoughts, good action, good deeds in an organization creates a conducive environment for people to be friendly. In one of the conversations with one CEO, he was there, part of the top 500 organization, the best places to work in India. He was saying that my role as a CEO is not to create pressure on my people. Whatever pressure is there, I will absorb. But what I do is to create a conducive environment where they feel welcomed in the organization. He beautifully explained that when I create a conducive environment, it's like giving the right soil and the right manure for the plant to grow. I can't suffocate the seed, not give it water, and expect the seed to perform. So when you speak about karma, we are speaking about creating a positive belief system, creating good vibes, creating a good platform for people to express themselves without having to worry about what will happen to them. Some of the Fortune 100 companies today does not speak about retention, or they do not speak about firing at all. They say that you come, you go whenever you choose, as long as you're comfortable. One thing that they do is they hire the people with the right set of attitude, the right set of belief system. But what do you bring to the table? You see, if two of us are speaking, suddenly somebody enters the call, it completely throws the call off balance because of that one person's dynamic in the call. Likewise, every action, every deed, every thought, every belief system that we help our people to create will have its own impact on the result. It's like driving a car, sir. I decide to drive from, say, Mumbai to Chennai by car. And I know the distance is about 1,700 kilometers, but I can't see Chennai from Mumbai. Maximum I can see is 200, 300 meters. If I'm able to focus that 200, 300 meters repeatedly well, I'm sure that I'll reach Chennai without any major issue or accident, and I'll safely reach. The same is true for karma. If I'm able to focus on giving the right platform, I know where I have to go, but I don't need to push that burden on the driver every 5 minutes. You have to go to Chennai, you have to go to Chennai. It's not going to work. So it's about creating a positive platform where people do not have the pressure of having to worry only about the results. We speak about lead indicators in corporate life. When you speak about balance scorecard, we speak about lag indicators, which is about results. The theory on the balance scorecard done by Robert Kaplan and others in the 90s shows that the more you focus on the input, the output takes care of itself. The same thing what Lord Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita. He says, focus on the, he tells Arjun, shoot the arrow. Do not worry whether the person will get killed or not, because that is something that is already, he says, I have taken care of it. In our case, maybe we don't know. So that is a concept that I've woven into this book, sir. I'm keeping it short. I hope that I communicated the point.
Yeah, that's excellent. You know, now coming to my favorite part of any organization, because I always believe in people, and because you're as a CEO, or the performance purely based on the people. So, you know, in your book, have you touched upon the spiritual aspect of a CEO, but how can you make an inclusive organization which will be, you know, more or less equal to what you are thinking, your thought process? Have you touched that part in your book?
Yes, sir. In fact, being a strategy consultant, you will surely know that strategy flows from the goals that you want to set for the organization and the vision that they have. But where actually many of the strategies fail in many organizations that I work with is that there is no clear, value system path that is being set for people. I have a separate chapter in this book called A Spiritual DNA. What are the common denominators? I mean, you might have an organization where people from multiple religious faiths would work. So you can't say that worshiping God or going to a temple has a spiritual value. Obviously, that will be a clash of interest. But there are certain value systems in terms of helping people to express themselves. Everyone at some point of time, when they cross the threshold of having to earn enough money, after that, they want to express themselves and do something positive, either for the organization or for the society. But many organizations with the vision that they have, which is a sort of a tunnel vision, which wants them only to focus on maximizing turnover and profit. These people feel as if their true self hasn't come out. I have looked at organizations like Google and other places where some of the top executives work are known to me. They all say that we can do whatever we want. The system is such that the results will automatically come. Matured organizations do not worry about results. Organizations which are yet to mature in the what we call the continuous maturity model, they're always worried about results. At some point of time, they realize that the efforts and the value system which creates the platform is what finally makes the results possible. I'm not saying don't take the focus off the results, but do not compromise on the values. And one full chapter dedicated on spiritual DNA, which leads to what I call as a spiritual alchemy. Alchemy is a process of converting a metal into a higher grade metal, say from tin to copper, copper to gold, and things like that. Likewise, a normal human being, the way a butterfly metamorphosizes from an egg, goes through the cocoon process, become a worm, and then finally it becomes a butterfly. Every human can actually be allowed to flourish to the full extent. And that's what I believe that the spiritual DNA chapter completely actually focuses on.
Excellent. Excellent, Gagash. Another factor which I'd like to know from you is, see, from your extensive research for the book, you might have come across a few X factors. Could you share that? What are the? I know it's not easy to comprehend in few words, but at least in a few X factors which you have identified as the key to be a spiritual, successful CEO?
So to be a spiritual CEO, the point I'll take from where you covered in the earlier question about people. Building trust and respect amongst people is something which is the X factor in my view, which will help organizations to go multiple folds. When I say trust, it's not the trust that as we understand as defined in the dictionary. Here, trust is when I define something like this. Trust is when the person who is associated with you at any level in the organization has an intrinsic belief system that any decision taken in the organization covers their interest. For example, as a CEO, you sign an order for increasing pay or decreasing staff or whatever. When I am automatically convinced without even having to be convinced by anybody that if my CEO does it, I know it will be for my good. And that kind of trust is going to take a lot of value systems for the CEO to practice before someone can believe in them. It can take even 2 to 3 years time. The second word what I speak about is respect. Respect is when, see, as a CEO, if somebody wants to say 4 or 5 levels lower than he wants to walk into your room and question you about a decision you have made in proper language, not being very rough or whatever. And if they can walk out without having the fear that you're going to take punitive action against them. In many organizations, I have found that the amount of time that is wasted in managing people is more than the amount of time wasted in focusing on results. There are internal conflicts, there are lack of belief system, people don't trust each other. When my teammate takes a decision, I believe that he is doing something to sabotage my interest. When I go and express myself, I'm worried whether HR or somebody else will take action against me for expressing myself. People live in constant fear inside the organization. One, not being able to express themselves. Second, not knowing which decision is going to impact them. These two core values, in my view, as far as the people are concerned, are the X factors if the CEO focuses. In my view, for that, he must have a spiritual bent of mind. What do we mean by a spiritual bent of mind? Being a little bit compassionate. The ability to listen without prejudice, being able to accept the other people's faults. These are all very simple things. This is what Christ taught, this is what Buddha taught, this is what the prophet taught, this is what every religious leader speaks. That's where the marriage happens. That's exactly the point. As the one X factor I would share for your question.
Thanks. That's really a great, Prakash. And you know, see, one more much widely debated topic is on the purpose. Because I believe, you know, you need to have a personal purpose, which if you can convert that into the professional purpose, it will be good. Because if you ask me personally, I keep two core elements as a purpose in my life. It's one, to make sure you raise the level of, you know, people around you, either financially or by the skill sets. That is one. Second thing is what I keep it is be there when they need you the most. So, you know, this I've tried it in my life and been successful. What do you think, you know, from your book, have you come across this, the element of purpose and importance of it?
I have, sir. One point which has been around in the corporate circle since mid-90s, is a famous slogan which is coined by some Harvard professor called Purpose Over Profit. I'm very sure you'd have come across it. In this book, I touch upon spirituality. Many people confuse spirituality with very confined religious beliefs. They think that spirituality is about my belief system, about my acceptance of a specific God, the rituals I do and things like that. I have codified or recodified spirituality in this book completely differently. I have said that spirituality is when I allow my peace, my happiness, and my growth to coexist with the other person's need to have peace, happiness, and growth. If you are able to satisfy this, in fact, you have bought a world integrated platform where everybody can say, I want to be peaceful at the end of the day. I want to be happy with my family, with some savings, some kind of comfort, basic luxuries, whatever. And I want growth. If these three things are guaranteed, and while pursuing this, I don't interfere or tread on somebody else's legs or toes, and we are able to coexist, I can say that at least at an entry level, all of us are spiritual. To that extent, the purpose is I want to be peaceful, I want to be happy, I want to grow in whatever field I choose. And I want you to do it as well. And this organization, the CEO, should be an enabler who allows that. Instead of me pushing for growth, if the person chooses to run after growth, what is better, one CEO focusing on 100 people or 100 people focusing on their growth on their own efforts, which would be better?
Sure. Yeah, now while I've taken much of your time, I have one or two questions more. One is, from your extensive experience among the spiritual characters or in our books, who will be one of the ideal CEO in Hindu?
If you want to take Hindu mythology, I don't want to quote any current living examples, because it will be like leaving one for the other. There are many. In fact, I quoted in the book itself specific names of Indian CEOs and CEOs from abroad who are good examples of practicing, and they're still evolving. For me, the all-time CEO who manages all well is Lord Krishna himself, or for that matter, Christ, or for that matter, many of the prophets or many of the saints who have gone through the world. If you take Buddha, he was a great king. He failed on his personal life, but he was a great king. And then he became a saint and he attained Buddhahood. If you look at even the life of Krishna, which I've touched upon in this book, because it connects to many of the Indian belief systems. If you look at the 9 avatars that Lord has apparently taken till now, the last one is considered to be the Purna avatar, where he's supposed to be aware that he's God, and yet he lives a human life balancing both. If you take any of the earlier ones, he was not aware of what his godly qualities were. He metamorphosized and became Lord Krishna. And of course, one more avatar is supposed to be left. Whether people believe in mythology or not, I am taking these as placeholders to communicate a point. Whether you started at Varaha avatar or went on to become the fish or went on to become Narasimha avatar, each CEO goes through this process of metamorphosizing. And ideally, they're able to maintain a balance of what Lord Krishna was, sthita pragyan, as they say, maintaining poise and balance in all situations. That's what finally helped. You see, even some CEOs whom I coach, they all get tensed and worked up when they are put under pressure. And their mind goes crazy. They take decisions which they repent later. I tell them, if you just are able to maintain poise, maintaining spiritual values, knowing that this too shall pass, and what more really you need. When I'm able to, like what the Lord Krishna says, which I've shared in the book, your ability as a spiritual person is to look at the event as a witness rather than being part of it. That way you're not attached. That's what he also says. These are easily actually something that can be practiced. No, actually doesn't need too much of knowledge or jnana or wisdom. People know it. It's a question of creating that awareness that they can practice. And that's what I've done in this book, just to kindle their interest and make them look at certain aspects which they all along they knew. Many of the CEOs are well-read, knowledgeable, except in the heat of the financial pressure, they forget these value systems.
Sure. And before we conclude, one last question to you.
Sure, sir.
Now we have a lot of young CEOs coming, because earlier, you have the you have the image of a CEO because you have to be certain age certain experience. But now it is not like a very young guys coming into this helm of affairs. What is your advice to these young kids who are coming into this?
In fact, I wouldn't call it as an advice, but I do interact with many of the young CEOs in the age group of 20, 25, because as part of the succession planning in many organizations, we do deal with the next generation of, I have been dealing with some organizations for 15, 20 years. These were all school-going kids. Now they've gone to Harvard, London School of Economics, somewhere. They finished something and come back with loads of ideas. Loads of thinking, loads of fresh thinking that they want to implement in their business. I only tell them one thing, keep the flock together by maintaining certain basic value systems. A king is only as good as the flock. You can be a CEO in a room where there is nobody, or you can be a person in an organization where there are 100, 200 working who would love to work with you. If you're able to work towards that, that's good enough. People should love to work for you, not for your organization alone. Become that CEO, a leader who people would love to work with. People will produce the results. I have seen that people never normally let you down unless you badly backstab them or deny them opportunities to grow. You give them the platform, they will go ahead. Like the recent advent of the Indian cricket team. You can have 3-4 teams without any compromise. It's because you believed in the system, you allowed people to grow, nourish them, they'll come out and perform. As a young CEO, allow people to be what they are. Give them certain basic value systems. Support them. I'm very sure that you'll do far better than what your predecessors have done.
Thank you. That's excellent, Prakash. Thanks a lot for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Anil.
Wish all the best for the book. And I know this will definitely resonate well within the CEOs and, like what you mentioned, even non-CEOs, even including housewives and other readers.
I also thank you, Mr. Anil, because with your professional experience and background, actually, if I interview, I'm very sure the viewers will get so much of knowledge from your side. But in spite of that, you really played it well, where you allowed me to express some of the views. I really appreciate that space that you're given. And this is exactly what a good spiritual CEO would do. And thanks a lot. Hats off to the way you're doing. Thank you, sir. My pleasure.